minutes early so I can get a few more few extra minutes. Are you sure you can hear me? Because when I was sitting back there, it was very difficult to hear. Okay, all right, good. All right, my name is Brad Scoggin. I'm a co-founder and CEO of Springboard VR. And 12 months ago, the world thought that VR arcades were a joke. The major companies scoffed at it. Most content creators didn't want to mess with it. But they were wrong. Over the last 12 months, we've seen nearly 100 new locations coming online per month outside of Japan, Korea, and China. And the cool part of that, to me, is that it's the VR arcades, it's the LBE market that is actually sustaining VR and propelling the growth right now. And the folks that are running these locations are not the well-funded, high-experienced guys. It's indies. These are indie locations. It's a couple friends in their hometown who got passionate about VR and were willing to take a risk. And businesses and entrepreneurship is hard enough in its own right. But to do it inside an emerging industry, you basically decided to jump out of a plane and knit the parachute on the way down. And we were in the same boat. So October of 2016, I put on a headset for the first time and was totally blown away by the technology. A week later, we decided, let's open up a VR arcade. And so we put together a business plan, and like any good entrepreneur, we made up some projections to raise money. Can I get an amen for making up projections to raise money? Yes. Okay, I think all the VCs will be here tomorrow. So that's a joke. We don't do that. We're a data-driven company. And that's the whole point of the stock, right? So we raise the money. We get the gear, and we're going through our processes. And the idea is that we're going to launch 4 weeks later on Black Friday because we don't know what we're doing, and we think the holiday rush will cover over all of it. So we get the gear, we're going through the processes, and we realize we're totally screwed because there's no way to manage this. And so we're going to have to hire at least double staff we had planned, which is going to totally kill the slim margins we had already made up for our investment, right? And so that was basically the genesis of Springboard. Springboard is experience management and content distribution for VR, and we built the first version just to solve our own pain point and save money on employee overhead. So we launched Black Friday. We had a great holiday season. We survived. We're watching the market, and we're seeing the growth that I talked about a minute ago. And it was in March of 17 that we decided to bet on the software business. We said, okay, we're going to build a company completely devoted to the software solution. We're going to do the LinkedIn marketing, all that crap, right? But we said we're going to focus on two things. Because at that point, the industry was still very volatile. We said we're going to focus on building really good relationships with operators and with content creators. And then we're going to become experts in their pain points. So we're just going to serve them to the best of our ability. So if the whole thing blew up in 6 months, hopefully we would have enough relational capital to pivot to whatever was next. And that was the best decision we could have made. We officially launched our company a year ago at this conference with 40 locations on the platform. I'm happy to tell you today that we have over 300 locations using the platform in 30 countries, and we're up to just over 3 million minutes being played through our system on a monthly basis. We do define ourselves now, as I mentioned before, as experience management and content distribution. We work in a number of verticals, primarily still focused on the entertainment vertical. And within that vertical, you've got family entertainment centers. We're working with everything from casinos and cruise lines all the way down to movie theaters, trampoline parks, and then, of course, the arcades. And at this point, the arcades still do make up the bulk of our customers. And so what we've done over the last few months is we've done a deep dive into the data that we've been collecting over the last year. We've done extensive interviews with operators, with content creators, and we've partnered with universities and data analysts to do pretty ridiculous surveys. And we found, we believe, are seven factors that are important to the success of the arcade. And so we've been doing a pretty, pretty extensive study, and make sure you come to our website, springboardvr.com. We've already released two articles, but more articles coming. You can sign up for our newsletter, and we're going to do a very deep dive on a number of these points. We do feel like we feel a certain level of responsibility with our positioning that when we come out with a recommendation, we do, all jokes aside, we do want to make sure that it is based on evidence and data. We want to be very specific with that. So I'm going to hit a couple today, though, that I think will be actionable, whether you are thinking about looking up a location or whether you're already running a location, based on our analysis of the last few months. So first thing we'll talk about is marketing. So it shocks me a little bit that still to this day, if I ask 8 or 10 operators, 8 of them are going to say their number one challenge is people not knowing what we are. And I'm sure that if you all try to explain to your family and your friends what you do, you understand. I think I've told my parents 20 times what I do with them. So here's our recommendation for marketing. If you're going to spend $5,000 on marketing this year, don't spend it on digital media. Don't spend it on flyers. Buy a t-shirt headset or two, and pay and get an employee to go to every event you're set. Go to camp, university campuses, go to the parks, go to the churches, go to the festival, and just get people in VR. That's the only way people are going to know what VR is. Get them in VR. Demo, 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 and then give them a coupon or whatever it takes to get them back. As soon as you get them to your store, your number one objective becomes, how do I turn this customer into a VP person? So we have a pretty quick thing. And some of this may seem pretty basic, but you'll be surprised as we look at 300 arcades who's doing well. So first of all, it needs to have a professional look. Okay, again, I know that's very basic, but it's very clear when we look at who's being successful and who's not, that appearance does matter. Here's some examples of some of the arcades you work with. These are all places that you would want to go. You might take your family. These are cool places. Very different style. So the style doesn't matter, but there needs to be some sort of thing. When you've got a great, very long blog post that goes into a lot of detail on customer experience. The second part is that it needs to be run professionally. So that's where Springboard can help a lot. So part of our experience management has to do with the end headset launch. So we've got a beautiful 360 launch environment that has been built on feedback in 300 locations over 12 months. So it's very user-friendly. And the whole idea is that you put the headset on a three-year-old or on your grandma, and they navigate their entire experience on their own. I know I'm getting a look here that you shouldn't put a three-year-old VR on your right. But you get the point, right? We want them to be able to navigate their experience without the employee assistance. Second thing is we've got a back-end that your manager or operator can use to manage one station, 20 stations, one location, 20 locations. Everything is between. We've got a booking system that can be embedded into your website, or you can use in-store, we've got user profiles that go along with that, and then of course all the data and analytics that come with all that. I'm doing super high level, make sure you come by our booth, we can go through a deep dive with that. And then of course content. Content is very important. Speaking of content, we're here just a minute. We do have an online marketplace, we handle commercial licensing to make that more efficient. We release each month our top 20 most played titles, so we can give operators an idea of what popular titles are. Second thing is price. And this is a fun one. And we're going to come out with some very specific recommendations. But this is what I'll say today. You don't want a customer that's looking to pay for a high-end experience a couple times a year. You want a customer who's going to come in a couple times a month. And so your price point has to reflect that. Across the board, we look at successful operators versus unsuccessful operators. This is a huge point of view. So what I would say to you, and I understand we're working in 30 or 40 countries now, so again, these are somewhat generalizations. But if you're looking at North America, you need to not be charging in the $45 to $60 an hour rate. It needs to be in the $20 to $25 an hour rate. That is something that drives your repeat business. And then the third thing, I think everybody is pretty clear on the community series that you've got to have. Again, across the board, our most successful operators, multiplayer is the foundation of the business. And one of our operators, I'll quote him, he said he works with the same assumption that people do with movies, that somebody doesn't want to go to the movies, but it's the same thing with VR. So you've got to bring in the social element. There's a lot of good VR, but multiplayer games out there to do that, which we can help you with and show you the game. We do have, releasing Monday, we're releasing a massive rebuild of our entire product. We've been heads down for months, version 3.0. I'm very excited about that. We will continue today. But once that launches on Monday, building out our multiplayer offering, and not from a content perspective, but from the ability to get into multiplayer experiences at one location, with multiple stations, and then even multiple locations, that's top of our roadmap. So last thing I'll talk about is content. And of our 7 success factors, this is probably the one I'm most passionate about because it impacts everybody the most, in my opinion. And it affects the whole ecosystem. And it's the relationship between the content creator and the operators and some of the tension that exists there. And we see ourselves as kind of the middleman, but
But more than that, that our success, so if we're going to be minded to just focus on our own success, that means that both operators and developers have to be successful. So we're somewhat in a unique position that we see the full picture, and that if we operate under our own bias, it helps everybody be successful. And so, a couple things here. So quality. I know there's various opinions on quality. We are working with content creators with our data to help them create content that works in location-based. We've got a lot of feedback, we've got a lot of data. We release the top 20 titles every month. Part of our new build is coming out that the end user has the ability to upvote or downvote content. So part of our vision is that we want to be able to give content creators access and space in the LB market, but ultimately we want to put the power in the hands of the consumer. We don't want to be the gatekeeper. We want the consumers to be the ones to determine what content is good. We will take that data, go back to the content creators, and help them create better content, which again, we all have. And I do think, well, there's one point here that is also just important to keep in mind, that generally speaking, today, content is not what's driving this market. People are not going to the arcade because they want to play Halo, or whatever it may be. They're going to the arcade because of the novelty of the arcade. Now once they get there, they get in Quiver, they get in Arizona, whatever it is, now they come back to play that. That's something we have to keep in mind as we're looking at the ecosystem today, the content is not the driver yet, for the most part. The second thing is distribution. And especially, obviously, in the out of home market here, it's very fragmented, and that's one of the problems that we are trying to address. I think we've done a fairly good job so far, bringing 300 locations together, and we're still growing rapidly every month. But what that allows us to do is go to these content creators and offer them a more efficient way to monetize their content. We can put 300 locations together instead of having to go hunt down the mom and pop locations on their own. And so that means two things. That means that Hollywood studios, content studios are now more willing to invest more money in content because there is an efficient way to monetize it. But it also means that they're willing to charge less because we can guarantee them a higher level of volume. Which leads me into, let me see what I'm doing now. We are also coming out with our own content hosting. Right now we still utilize Steam for our content distribution, but in the next few months we'll be doing our own hosting, which just needs another kind of layer of efficiency out of the process. And it also helps us to address piracy, we all know something that's happening and we don't know what we're talking about, but it's something that's got to be addressed if we're looking at the health of the entire ecosystem. So, the last point is price. And so, this may be where the most interest is. And I think one of the challenges here is that if everybody's honest, for the most part, you don't know what your VR is worth. And so, even if you go back to what people are charging per hour, if I called an arcade store, how did you make $45 an hour? They'll say, well, we copied this guy, and everyone's just guessing, right? So, we launched our content licensing at the end of last year. At that time, we had about 800 headsets. So we were in a position to go to a content creator and leverage that volume to get lower prices. But we said, no, that is very premature. That is bad for the whole ecosystem. If we're trying to drive the prices to the floor, before we have any data. So what we did is we started very simple with a permanent pricing model. We gave the content creators the ability to set their price, we gave total transparency of price, and then we gave operators the ability to opt in or opt out. And we knew we were going to catch a lot from operators, we knew it was going to be messy, but we wanted to get the data. And it's been awesome. It's been messy. We've seen the adoption grow every month, which is really encouraging to me because I'm looking at saying, wow, everyone's guessing still kind of within this deal, but it's still growing. People are still adopting the pricing. And so we're at a point now where we have a lot of good data. And this is where we definitely got to stay tuned. In the next month or so, we've got some exciting announcements around content, specifically around the price point that we believe people need to be getting to for operators to be successful. I mean, shocked, a lot of operators aren't even thinking about this and the detail they need to be, because this is a huge, huge part of the business. And then going back to content creators and saying, look, really everybody's going to have to give a little. If we want this whole thing to be successful, which if arcades fail, operators fail, excuse me, content creators fail, and vice versa. So operators, you're going to have to be a little bit more than you want to pay. Content creators, you're going to charge a little bit less. But if we're all willing to be more, things will be more successful. So please, come connect with us. Our booth is right here. And a little feedback, sorry. Sign up for our newsletter. We've got a lot of great data and blog posts coming out around all the 7 success factors, especially around content in the next month or so. Sign up for our newsletter. Come check us out at our booth. You can check out our new version, the 3.0. And we do offer a free 30-day trial, so anybody's thinking about switching, you can get it set up at your arcade and you'll play around for 30 days. Look, this is awesome. This is so exciting. This is an exciting time in VR. It's exciting that the locations are actually, as Ilya said earlier, they're the ones sustaining and propelling the growth of VR. So let's work together to make data-driven, informed decisions, and let's continue to prove it out drunk.